My aunt drove us to the depot an hour and a half before the train's scheduled arrival time. She had to park the car many blocks away. I was 11, and we joined the throng of hundreds of people milling about, moving ever closer to the section of the tracks where they imagined the train would likely stop. The train was half an hour late, but this did not diminish the size of the crowd waiting in the hot Texas sun. As the train rolled in and came to a stop, the crowd pushed forward with increased momentum. In addition to feeling almost smothered by the press of the people, I became aware that I was moving, but my feet were not touching the ground. The crowd of people was propelling me forward. Eventually, the crowd was stopped. President Franklin D. Roosevelt and Eleanor Roosevelt appeared at the back of the train, waving, and a little girl presented Eleanor with an armful of roses. I had spent much of the summer of 1936 at my grandmother's house in Denison, Texas. Franklin and Eleanor Roosevelt were making a cross-country trip via train. Some of the city officials, no doubt staunch Democrats, prevailed upon the planners of the entourage to make a whistle stop in Denison. The town had been abuzz with the prospects of the presidential visit. When the day came, it was decided that Grandma was not feeling well enough to deal with the heat and the crowds, but my aunt would go to the train station and take my cousin and me. It was a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to see a real-life president of the United States. I had no problem deciding what to wear. It would be my dusty rose lace dress with the matching color grosgrain ribbon sash. The Montgomery Ward catalog was a real wish book in our household in the 30s. Shopping opportunities were limited in the small town of Alney, Texas. And besides, prices were cheaper in the catalog than in locally owned stores. Though I was considered to be from a family of wealth by some of my schoolmates because Daddy worked at the bank where all that money was kept, The truth was that my parents struggled to make ends meet on the small salary the bank paid Daddy. Items we ordered from the catalog ranged from lengths of fabric for Mother to sew to kangaroo leather shoes for Daddy, which would enable him to hop like a kangaroo. He almost had us kids convinced. Santa must have had access to the Montgomery catalog also. Come Christmas morning one year, my sister received the doll she had wished for, pictured on page 247 of the catalog. That was the year I got my gold cross necklace found on page 114. The big splurge was the mahogany Duncan Fife dining room furniture, a longtime wish of my mother's. The spring I was 11, we ordered fabric for my Sunday best dress of the season. I was excited by Mother's decision to make the dress of lace. I got to choose the color, dusty rose. It took about 10 days for the order to arrive, and I excitedly dreamed how beautiful the dress would be and how elegant I would look wearing it. When the order arrived, I was a little disappointed in the quality of the fabric. The lace was stiff and coarse-looking, and the dusty rose fabric color rather dull. The fabric cut to length was a non-returnable item, so I had to hope the dress would make up pretty. Fortunately, it did seem to improve when it took on the form of a dress. Mother added a 2-inch wide matching grosgrain ribbon for a sash, and that was a nice touch. And it turned out it would be the perfect dress to see a president. Both Franklin and Eleanor said a few words. I was close enough to hear the sound of their voices, but not near enough to differentiate their words. I had heard the president speak on radio. His speech was a little foreign to my southern ears when he said such things as, "We have nothing to fear but fear itself." But I had never heard Eleanor speak before and was unprepared for the high-toned shrillness of her voice. I think I had imagined she would speak in soft, dulcet tones. She wasn't very pretty either. I had the notion that like queens and princesses, the first lady of the land should be beautiful. But pretty or not, even at the age of 11, I recognized her gracious, genteel manner. After a scheduled 20-minute stop, the train whisked the Roosevelts away and the crowd began to disperse. It was then that I noticed my grosgrain ribbon sash was missing, pulled away from my body by the push and shove of the crowd. But I considered the loss of a ribbon sash small sacrifice for the privilege of having seen the President of the United States of America. I had been well-dressed for this most special occasion of my young life. I wore my dusty rose lace dress made by my mother's skilled hands from fabric ordered from the Montgomery Ward catalog.